Described by David Lynch as the main guy, the number one kind of hero painter, Francis Bacon was born on October 28, 1909, in Dublin, Ireland. As if predisposed to steer a forever questioning ship, while alive, Bacon found himself inspired by surrealism, present in both film and photography, and this consequently resulted in him indulging in a style of art that has made him one of the most widely recognized creators of figurative art from the 1940s and 1950s. Never once painting a figure that wasn't misshaped in some way, his unwavering penchant for controversial honesty has made his work amongst the most acclaimed and sought after in the market.
Hello out there, my name is Christina. Welcome or welcome back to my channel. This is the place where we gush about the films that we love and try to understand the ones that we don't. Here we go. Today I'm going to be talking about the 1998 made-for-TV film called Love is the Devil, Study for a Portrait of Francis Bacon that was made in 1998. It was directed and written by John Maybury and is based off of a biography called The Gilded Gutter Life of Francis Bacon that was written by Daniel Farson. Starring Derek Jacobi and Daniel Craig, it is a fictionalized version of Francis Bacon's life. However, it focuses on the constrained relationship that he had with small-time petty thief George Dyer. Here we go.
Alright, I'll take Things That Likely Never Happened for $200.
Not much of a burglar, are you? Come to bed, and you can have whatever you want.
Love's the Devil leads with the impression that Dyer and Bacon's relationship started after a botched attempt at robbery that Dyer took out on Francis Bacon's place of residency. This is based off a rumor, and their real point of origin couldn't have been more pedestrian. Alright, this is a little more appropriate. The relationship between Dyer and Bacon started in 1961 after they met inside of a Soho pub. According to Bacon, the two were far away from one another in this bar, and it was Dyer who approached Francis, saying that he, Francis and company, looked like they were having a very good time and he wanted to buy him a drink. Cheers to that. Very much aware of the sort of mythology surrounding how they met, Bacon never went out of his way to refute claims that Dyer met him during a botched attempt at robbing his place of residency. There's reason to believe he thought doing so was pointless, owing to the fact that up to this point, Dyer had made a name for himself as a habitual offender. In fact, by the time he had turned 30, he had spent more time incarcerated and in various detention centers than he had outside of them. Dyer was never known to be particularly violent or dangerous as an individual, but he was drawn to a sense of lawlessness and ill-calculated risk. This made his approaching to Francis sort of the perfect precursor to the storm that would be his death. Any emotions Francis had regarding their relationship had been complicated by the fact that he did disclose emotions that he had. However, he did so with the agreement that they would not be released until following his own death in 1992.
Bearing this in mind, it isn't entirely the fault of Maybury or other people that have wanted to analyze Bacon's life that Love is the Devil ends up being a little bit incomplete. That said, there's little responsibility ascribed to extraneous factors that tested the relationship that was maintained between Dyer and Bacon up until October 23rd, 1971. Just make a quick note here that maintained is a very generous term to use, and we'll come back to that point later.
The likely observation following a go-round with Love is the Devil is its lack of art shown that Bacon completed in the almost decade he was enmeshed with Dyer. We have Bacon's estate to blame and thank for this, as they refused permission for their depictions to be used. And to call this a shame would be an understatement, as Bacon built up a reputation for being one to show the more grotesque aspects of the human experience in his art. This, of course, came with a label of controversy and subsequently served as a source of contention. In what is almost a redemptive stroke, Love is the Devil has enough sense to bring attention to images that Bacon kept on hand for sources of inspiration. Namely, a still entitled Screaming Woman from Sergei Eisenstein's battleship Potemkin. Released in 1925, it is a silent film which dramatizes a stirring of mutiny, and as such, ironically spoke Bacon's language. Though not referenced to in Love is the Devil, likely to its indirect relevance. Bacon was no stranger to domestic violence and affectionate withdrawal by the time he had met Dyer. At the age of 17, Bacon moved to London as a result of his homosexuality making him a social outcast with no support from his family. And one of his more serious partners prior to George, named Peter Lacy, regularly destroyed his paintings and beat him to the point of being nearly unconscious when drunk and enraged. Curiously, Love is the Devil offers little in terms of supposition, as it involves what Bacon could have ever been trying to say with his work, and is much less interested in exploring his medium of choice as a coping mechanism. One of the most obvious examples of this specific avenue of neglect is a scene which depicts an incident in which Francis was arrested for allegedly hiding marijuana in his studio. We're gonna watch it and talk about it. However, what I want you to know beforehand is that this incident happened in 1968.
Boys in blue with me here. Yeah, that's right. It's all right, Jeffrey. Yes, well, I think George has been telling tales. Yes, of course, that would be marvelous. I'll put him on. It would seem as though the situation is somewhat different since you spoke to Mr. Bates. fingerprint isn't charged. It's mere formality.
Well, I think I can already tell you, most probably, and place that substance here. It's more than likely the same person who suggested that you take it.
Sir, first of all, this isn't completely accurate in terms of where the marijuana was actually found when the police showed up to Francis's studio. The reason Francis immediately suspected that Dyer was responsible is because the marijuana was found in a statue that Dyer had previously gifted to him.
Rather disturbed gentleman who works for me as an odd job man.
We'll let the court decide that, sir.
The court? Oh.
This incident goes unmentioned for the rest of Love is the Devil, but it did inspire some of Bacon's most popular works. To quote Bacon, "At the time of my arrest, and for a long time after, I stayed furious. To release some of the tension, I straightaway went to my easel and did a large painting. He," meaning Dyer, "is sitting on a chair with the nasty flattened police dog at his feet sniffing towards the statue, which becomes George's head." The result of Bacon's impassioned painting was two studies of George Dyer with dog, which was completed in 1968 and now resides in a private collection. Rendered in one of the artist's patently fraught psychological landscapes, the work underwent a series of revisions. At first, the sculpture in the painting's foreground represented the statue where the pot was hidden. That eventually changed into the image of the police dog sniffing towards the statue, as Bacon described it. Then it finally became a depiction of George's head. Bacon was eventually acquitted of these possession charges, but he still had to pay legal fees totaling approximately $68,500. Admittingly, Love is the Devil utilizes very little nuance in its depiction of the relationship that was had between Dyer and Bacon, and portrays Dyer as this overzealous and subservient watchdog. This isn't too much of a surprise, given how little was known about Dyer, outside of the qualities that attracted Bacon to him. And furthermore, there's little documentation to suggest that anyone cared about Dyer's input in any given situation to begin with. Consequently, this has forced historians to make their own conclusions regarding the psychologically codependent and harmful relationship Dyer had with his last and only identified lover, such as the fact that Bacon gave him enough means to virtually eliminate his need to burglarize resources people need to survive. This would eventually turn into enabling Dyer's alcoholism and other addictive behaviors, but this probably goes without saying. Most important is the likelihood that Bacon's association helped Dyer climb up a social hierarchy-related ladder that is neither static or controlled by the status quo. Bacon, who was known for making art that is considered novel, was especially vulnerable to comments made by peers and his audience that suggested Dyer's value as a subject was overstaying its welcome.
Welcome to the concentration of camp.
Piss off, Dickie, I'm really sick of it.
I'll talk to you after you've had a shave.
In conjunction with Dyer being socially inseparable from the paintings he inspired, it might be fair to assume that any feeling of alienation or diminished self-worth might be magnetized in such a context. It didn't help that Dyer never pretended to enjoy or really understand the gravity of the opinions that Bacon's company offered him. The same company, mind you, that attracted him to Bacon to begin with. In short, the burden of being Bacon's most celebrated muse is what Love's the Devil fails to transpose, and this unfortunately oversimplifies the dynamic it claims to want to explore. If not convinced, consider this. The evening before Bacon's exhibition was due to debut in Paris, he offered to share a hotel room with George. However, he quickly abandoned him upon finding out that George brought company with him that has only been described as an Arab boy with smelly feet.
George's lifeless body, having died by suicide, was found the next day by Bacon, and he conspired with the hotel manager to ensure this news would not be reported for at least 2 days. No one knows for sure why Bacon worked so hard to make sure this news was suppressed. However, it could be obvious. This would constitute as bad press and could be potentially damaging to a mile marker in Bacon's career. This certainly isn't a fun fact, but it might further contextualize the experience that Bacon had when it came to being intimate with others. Lacey, as mentioned earlier, died from alcoholic-related complications mere hours before Bacon was due to have an exhibition debut in London. Even crazier than that, and most ironic, he died in 1962. And guess what? This was about a decade after Bacon had met him as well. In the end, I can't be too disappointed, and I do have to give credit where it's due. Love's the Devil does a good enough job at illustrating how much of Dyer's life likely felt like a prison even when he was incarcerated. The final shot behind me of him being especially visceral. In its leads, Jacobi particularly delicately sink their teeth into Farson's source material. That said, for a movie that so glowingly calls itself a study for a portrait of Francis Bacon, it is much too enthusiastic about playing hot potato with dire consequences. You made it to the conclusion. Thank you so much for tuning in with me today. As usual, questions, comments, concerns, and critiques are encouraged and welcome below. In addition to suggestions as to what movies I should watch and dig deeper with next. This has been Christina. Happy film hunting and have a great day.